Hello, this is IJ Wilson, and thanks for tuning in to the Halloween Listening Party on FOTW Radio. I hope you're all having a great Halloween. Tonight is a night of costumes, dressing up and having fun. It's usually a little bit spooky, as we play games in the dark and walk the streets at night. But we still have little beacons of light, in the form of jack-o'-lanterns, here and there to help keep us safe. We also usually like to listen to music, which I guess is why many of you are here listening with me. And so tonight I'm presenting a show called The Halloween Canon, where you'll hear an interview with George Stryker, a composer who has recently added his own work to the canon of Halloween music. Now maybe when I mentioned the Halloween canon, you imagined an actual canon that when it goes off, lots of little creatures come flying out, but also a shower of lollies, sweets and candy, whatever you might call them, in your part of the world. But for this story, a canon is just a body of work, where over time, the work of lots of different creative people get assembled together by collectors and enthusiasts. In our case, it's all the wonderful music that gets played each year at Halloween, like this one.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld an eerie sight, for my monster from his slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
Or perhaps this. It could even be this one. Whatever it is, we all have our favourites. And by sharing them with each other, we've built up our own canon of Halloween music. Anyway, enough from me, let me introduce you to George. George Stryker is a composer living in Burbank, Hollywood, who has worked on animations like The Legend of Halloween and Howard Lovecraft and The Frozen Kingdom. Most recently, he made the soundtrack for Corrective Measures, a feature film starring Bruce Willis and Michael Rooker. But more importantly, to listeners of this channel, a few years ago, he started working on a special concept album called Music of the Macabre, based around his love of Halloween. It was a massive undertaking, which involved working remotely with a full-scale orchestra, the Budapest Scoring Orchestra and Choir in Hungary. But let's hear from George himself about how it all came about.
Music of the Macabre kind of came out of COVID in a weird way. And it itself is a sort of macabre subject. But I remember over COVID, I was stuck back. I'm from Illinois originally, in Chicago, Illinois. And I got stuck back home for 7 months for the first time in probably over 10 years since I've left high school and moved out here. And I hadn't seen the seasons change in a long time. California notoriously has like zero seasons. So I experienced autumn for the first time in a long time. And Halloween in the Midwest, which is sort of that traditional Americana Halloween with the golden leaves and the cornfields and stuff like that. Pumpkins. And I was just awash with Halloween nostalgia for the 90s, which is when I grew up. And walking around town, seeing all the decorations. And I remembered a CD that I grew up with called Classics from the Crypt, which was Arthur Fiedler and the Boston Pops playing that kind of Halloween canon music, the Dance Macabres and the Hall of the Mountain King, Night on Bald Mountain, all that stuff. And I thought, I would really like to try to make something like that. And I feel like there's no CDs out there, aside from film scores and classical repertoire like Classics from the Crypt, hasn't been a lot of music, orchestral music, live orchestral music written for like Halloween. So that was kind of how I got the inspiration. And then it all sort of snowballed from there. And I started discovering old decorations and discovering, you know, revisiting old childhood haunts, so to speak, and home videos and stuff. And it was just like, wow, it was really strange because I'd never really unlocked that treasure chest of memories before. And I've always loved Halloween, but that for some reason, I think we all got really nostalgic over that period of time. And that was it for me. And then before I knew it, a year later, I had written an album and spent quite a bit of money.
I asked George if it was a difficult process bringing the album to life.
It was, but it was so much fun. And because I was doing it for myself, you just get obsessed with it. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how much money you're spending on it. It doesn't matter how much time you're spending. And I felt the crunch more when I finally decided when I'm going to release this thing. Because up till that point, I was just like, oh, I'll just write a track when I come up with a track. But you get so into it, you're like, I want to do another one, and I want to do another one. Oh, there's this, I want to write something that kind of feels like this. How did they do that? I'm going to try to, you know, sort of capture that same feeling. Like Berlioz, it was definitely one of the guys I wanted to try to sound like. It was The Witching Hour was kind of like a Symphony Fantastique a little bit, with a little Bernard Herrmann and stuff. And then Scherzo for a Harvest Moon was, you know, I want to sound like John Debney. I want to do Hocus Pocus so bad, you know, and then other stuff was direct inspiration from childhood, like Ghost of John or Memories of Halloween particularly was a big one. But it was exhausting for sure. I learned an insane amount about writing for orchestra, recording with an orchestra, learning how to run a session and how to prepare yourself for a recording session of that scale with pieces of varying complexity that take time for the players to figure out because they're playing this cold. They don't get the music beforehand. They're just sight reading this. But man, was it worth it.
There was one song in particular that jumped out for his listeners.
Memories of Halloween is, I think, my favorite track on the album because it is so personal. And because afterwards, when I wrote it, I knew it was my favorite track, but also when I released it, it reaffirmed how it was my favorite track because so many people immediately clicked with it. And it was all that sound, the ghost sound, the little theremin two-note interval thing, which I knew people remembered, but I didn't know how many people remembered that. Like it was really cool to do that. So that came about when I was back home and I found one of those old ghost decorations from the 90s. And I just remember, and I you know, it made the noise and I was like, oh my God, those are two notes. That's an interval. I could start a melody with that. Or it could just be the melody. It could be one, you know, sort of motif in the whole thing. And that just exploded from there because the feelings I got immediately hearing that, you can almost smell Halloween from when you were a kid. It takes you right back to where you were when you hear that sound. And that's really powerful. And I wanted to try to capture that sort of wistful nostalgia for a Halloween that maybe lives a little bit in fantasy in our minds now. And it's a Halloween. The whole piece to me sort of feels like you can never go back home. It's sort of like that was, it. So it has a spooky element to it to ground it in Halloween. But then to me, it's very kind of sad. It's kind of a sad piece of music. It's about a time you can never go back to. And that was written so fast because that just spilled out of me. And I remember walking in town. We had, this is in the middle of the fall, you know, dead trees and leaves on the ground crunching and cold air, and just walking by this old cemetery that we have in town, and just seeing on one side the cemetery, on the other side little houses with, oh, there's a pumpkin, there's a little, you know, scarecrow or something. And it's just a suburb, it's not rural or anything like that. But that just so, I almost wish I named the album Memories of Halloween, because I feel like that's the kind of title track for me.
But besides Memories of Halloween, there are other pieces that George is also fond of.
I think maybe the other one that I'm most happy with, as I run through the track list in my head really quick, is probably Samhain. I like that one a lot. Because I was actually, my goal with that was to write a somewhere in my memory, the Home Alone song, but for Halloween. I was like, what would that sound like? And originally I just wrote the choir. But then I wrote an orchestra around the choir, and I was like, oh, I got it. It's got to be that structure, the somewhere in my memory structure. And it kind of sounded like Harry Potter and stuff. Like, I got, you know, the big soaring string lines and stuff. But I'm pretty pleased with how that turned out.
Thank you.
I would change so much about a lot of these pieces now, just in having learned so much. But the few that hold up to me are probably that one and Memories of Halloween.
When I asked George what his quintessential Halloween song was, this is what he said.
Number one winner is always going to be in my book is Toccata and Fugue in D minor by Johann Sebastian Bach. That's just the first thing I think of when I think of Halloween, you know, the big pipe organ.
And the reason he liked it, went back to a CD called Classics from the Crypt.
I remember buying that CD with my dad at like a Best Buy or something when we were in the early 90s or something. God, I listened to that thing even when it wasn't Halloween because it was scary. It's creepy music. Like, there's, you know, they were short of having, I don't know, like Bartok on there or something that would just scare the hell out of a kid. but Night on Bald Mountain, but also just Dance Macabre is so great. And that's such a fun piece. And it always gets me in the mood for Halloween. I love that piece of music.
The interest in his album has been growing.
Certainly the listening numbers have gone up. I'm almost at 50,000 streams on Spotify, which is huge for me. This is just a little album. I don't have a marketing company behind me or anything. I do all my own marketing. It's all my own, you know, graphics and videos. And that's what I do as an editor. I work in advertising for film and TV here.
Speaking of graphics, one of the most important features of Music of the Macabre is its artwork.
Blake Armstrong did the main cover. And he is a poster artist here in Hollywood. And he has worked on stuff for Marvel and for huge, I think he even touched the Hocus Pocus 2 poster, if I'm not mistaken. I think he was one of the main artists on that. And then Scott Dewey, who was recommended to me by him, did all the interior 6-panel fold-out stuff that's in the CD album. But I knew, if I'm spending this kind of money on this thing, I have to have a good, it can't be something I made in Photoshop. It can't just be a jack-o'-lantern face. It has to be like a movie. And man, did those guys deliver. And I think that's been 80% of the reason anybody's listened to it.
Even though George has made a joke about why people might like his album, the truth is there is a lot to love about it. It's a completely heartfelt creation that resonates with young and old alike. It's a labor of love and a rekindling of the real reasons why so many people around the world love Halloween. One thing he said to me at the end of the interview was how supported he felt by the wider Halloween community.
It seems like it's a growing community too, which is, I think I'm catching the wave of that a little bit. But it's such a supportive community as well. The whole Halloween horror community is really cool, creative, and fun-loving people.
And this interview wouldn't have been possible without a couple of people from that same community who, in fact, first helped put George and me in touch.
I would also like to, because I know he's going to be listening to this, my friend Chris Lundy, who is a huge fan of Halloween Listening Party, and Megan McHugh, who I know will be listening to this. Hello, Chris and Megan. It's me, George. So.
And thank you, George, for a fantastic interview. If you want to know more about his work, you can visit his website, georgestryker.com. This last piece by him is called The Autumn Wind.